Good morning, everybody. We are going live on FB, and today's topic is overcoming guilt. And I would like Ali to start the session.
Very good morning, and very, very sorry for the delay. We have delayed it by 2 minutes. I think that is not the right thing to do. I'm feeling very bad that you people came on time. In fact, you came early. And we made you sit and you had to wait for us to start, and we should have been more punctual, isn't it? So I feel very bad that we have not started the program on time. That is guilt. Guilt, as you all know, is an emotion like any other emotion, but I give it a little more significance because the same way as we take up certain other emotions, let's say anger. Anger, I always point out, is a very debilitating emotion. Anger can cause a lot of harm. Kings get angry and they destroy nations. Person gets angry and he kills people. Somebody else gets angry and families break up and things of that sort. So while anger has got this tremendous power to cause harm to others, guilt has got a tremendous power to cause harm to oneself. That is one of the reasons why I give so much importance to guilt as compared to the other emotions. So when a person gets caught up in this guilt factor, guilt trap, whatever, I'll explain that in a minute. The fact is that one can be one's worst enemy. You can destroy your life much more than anybody else could ever destroy your life. So now let us see. What is this thing called guilt? As you know, every emotion comes from some thoughts. So what are the thoughts that lead to a person feeling guilty? There are various factors, many, many of them. But two of them which stand out most prominently. One of them is that if I feel that I have violated basic morals or principles or ethics, things which I believe in, that it has to be. Then if I feel that I have, violated that, then I feel guilty. The other prominent reason why people feel guilty is when a person thinks that he or she has hurt somebody or caused harm to somebody, willingly or sometimes even unwillingly, right? So that is how this emotion sort of arises. The moment I start getting these thoughts that I've either, trespassed on my morals and values, or that I have caused harm to somebody, either willingly or unwillingly or whatever it is. Now, when that happens, person starts feeling very uneasy. Obviously, the moment guilt hits you, things don't appear to be normal in the daily routine and this and that. You start getting to this thing, and then you start developing something like what we call as the fear of the unknown. What is going to happen? I have done this. What will be the outcome? All those type of things. Also leading to, in many, many cases, alienation from others. I better keep away from somebody. I'm a bad person. I may hurt someone, or someone may be looking down upon me because I've done this so-called bad deed. People may be looking down upon me. So the best thing to do is to keep away from people. And the more I isolate myself, the more I start valuing, in that guilt, self-pity, all these type of things. There are a lot of people who, when they feel guilty, start punishing themselves in various ways. I don't deserve this. I don't deserve that. A simple thing that, I would like to buy a new dress or eat an ice cream or something. No, I'm a bad person. I don't deserve it. Even when somebody else is trying to be nice to me and give me something, I say that no. I may not tell it to the person, but I will say that no, I don't deserve this, and I start withdrawing from those sort of things. Then of course, if you are a person with a lot of faith, you immediately start thinking about the fact that God is going to punish me. The karma factor, that if I do bad, there is a punishment attached to it. I will get it sooner or later, and in case I don't get it at all, I'll get it in my next janma. So the moment I start believing that there is going to be a punishment from God, the interesting thing is I start punishing myself. So let me first punish myself so that at least God will say, okay, this guy did these horrible things. But since he is already giving that punishment to himself, let me reduce the punishment which God Almighty would have normally given. Now, how does one give this punishment to oneself? Primarily by lowering of the self-esteem. I am unworthy, I am this and that. Motivation goes down. You don't even make attempts to do things which you are capable of doing. Start putting yourself down. And as I told you, denying oneself simple pleasures of life or simple things which I would have normally been doing. And the more I keep doing that, the more I keep indulging in that, the greater my self-esteem goes down. See, remember that guilt is only for specific actions. I hurt this person, or I did this thing which is classified as a sin. So therefore, I am guilty only of that, right? But that is not the end all and be all of everything that I have done. I have done some good things also, I have done some bad things also. If I can restrict my thoughts leading to the guilt only to that one particular factor, I can still move on in life. But somehow this guilt seems to be such an emotion that it encompasses. And therefore, my self-esteem starts, going down. That I am totally, overall, I am unworthy of whatever. Now, whatever I have done, if it is found out, if it becomes public, if people know that I have done this bad thing, then it converts into shame. I feel ashamed. I don't want to meet people because they know that I have done this bad thing. People must be laughing at me. People must be gossiping behind my back and things of that sort. So when it comes out in the open, that guilt converts into another emotion, which is like an add-on emotion called shame. Now I feel ashamed in front of people. And people who succumb to that very often even start presuming. My friend, who always used to give me a big smile, today when he saw me, he just gave a small smile and he moved on. Why? Because I think he knows that I have done these horrible things. He must be thinking that I am such a horrible fellow that I don't even deserve a proper smile from him. Whereas he was lost in his thoughts and he didn't even realize what he is doing and he just moved on. But I start reading meanings into the thing. So when it comes out in the open, the disadvantage is that I start thinking that the whole world knows what a horrible person I am. And now with social media and this and that, it is ensured also that everything goes viral and everybody knows what's happening. So I presume that the whole world knows, and the whole world has got nothing better to do except to think about the horrible thing that I have done. So that's what leads to this the shame factor. Achha, what happens if it is not found out? Many a time it becomes even worse. I start thinking, what if people find out? Here is somebody who is being nice to me, because that somebody does not know that I have done this horrible thing, right? But someday or the other, he or she is going to come to know that I have done this. Then what is going to happen? So should I even make friends? Should I even make attempts to be close to this person? Should I try to interact with this person? I do all that. And one fine day, this person comes to know about this murky past of mine and that I have done this horrible thing. So instead of losing out on that relationship, it is better that I start withdrawing right now. These are all the debilitating type of thoughts and actions and this and that, which become a vicious cycle where a person starts, going deeper and deeper into his own world, his own life and his own so-called, negativities. We forget one very simple thing, which is told in such a nice proverb, if you think about it, that every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. That is, if we can understand that little, theory or policy of life can be so much more simpler. So you look upon somebody, when you feel guilty, you inevitably compare yourself with others also. See, this person, all my friends, none of them have done this horrible thing which I have done. I'm the only person who's doing this bad thing. Why? Because people don't go publicizing what they have done. No? So people don't know what is happening. And since I start withdrawing into my shell and I don't discuss it out, I presume that I am the greatest sinner in this whole world. Nobody else has done all these horrible things which I am doing. And it starts growing. Now guilt on one aspect, one particular act that I have done is okay, that can happen to anybody. Sometimes I may even do it inadvertently. I may not realize that I have hurt somebody and then I regret saying that, oh, I have done this sort of thing. That is fine. But also remember that the frequency of feeling guilty and the intensity with which I feel guilty has a lot to do with your upbringing. If you are the type of person who has been brought up in this concept of paap and punya, sin and good deeds, clear dividing line, there are only heroes and villains in this world, so you have to belong to one of them. If you are not a hero, you are a villain, that's it. There are no gray areas between black and white. If our upbringing has been such, and if that belief has been strongly ingrained into us, and of course elders do it with good intention to prevent a growing person from indulging in something which may lead him or her into bad things. But if that has been drilled so strongly into me, that anything and everything becomes cause for guilt. So please review the upbringing and the type of rigid thinking pattern that was imposed into you in your formative years. If you do happen to have had that type of childhood, please be aware that the next time you do something which is even remotely, not right or not correct or not advisable, you're going to straight go down into that, thing of, because you set that, absolute benchmark that only this is right and everything else is wrong. Hero or you're a villain. The moment you start thinking in those terms of black and white, then things can be extremely bad every now and then. And people who keep indulging in this, emotion called guilt, every now and then, people who, smallest thing I do here and there and I start feeling guilty about it. By the time I'm recovering from that, I realize I have done something else and I start feeling guilty about that. I develop what behavioral scientists refer to as a guilt complex. It becomes part of my personality. And the interesting thing is, I am looking for some way to identify something that I can feel guilty about. Guilt becomes my comfort zone. So the moment I acknowledge that, yes, I've hurt this person or I've done this sin and all that, I actually feel relaxed because I know what it is. If I don't have that, I keep looking around to see, have I missed out on something? I must have done something bad. My elders always used to say, you should never do this, you should not. When I was a child, I was pointed out that, see, you're a horrible person, you have done this bad thing and all that. So in the last few days or last few weeks, how is it that I have not done anything wrong? Am I missing out? Am I in denial? So I start looking around to find out ways and means to say, ah, now I found out. Yeah, this horrible thing I've done, no? So now I'm comfortable. That is why I mentioned that as a guilt complex. It becomes part of your personality. Now, there are two ways in which people respond to that. One is to get out of this guilt trap. People start setting double standards. And the easiest way of setting double standards is to say everybody does it. There is a road on which, the traffic police has said parking is not allowed. There are signboards, they are very clear. Yeah, I go and park over there. And if somebody asks me that, as a law-abiding citizen, why are you parking your vehicle there? The typical answer is everybody does it. And that happens everywhere, from individuals to, you know, governments to international things and all that. You have done something wrong, so I have a right to do something wrong. And what you have done wrong is something that I am presuming and then putting a label on you, even if it is not proven. So if somebody points out to me and says, you have done this bad thing, I immediately point out and say, A, B, C have also done bad things. And even if it was 50 years back, still yes. You check, one of the most common factor in this is, you know, among politicians. If anybody points out to a politician or a political party that this is what you are doing wrong, our opposing party did that 100 years back. Why didn't you people speak about that? So and so did this. Why aren't you saying that? Why are you pointing out to me? Now, this is a defense mechanism by which a person tries to get out of it. I don't know how much the politicians succeed, but I can tell you that as individual citizens, it's not nice to do it. Because number one, you will never be aware that you're doing something wrong and you need to set it right. And secondly, deep down inside, you know that what you're doing is wrong and what you're saying is wrong. You may convince the others, you may put out the others, but it is like a disease which I have pressed inside my body, and from there that, you know, tumor is growing. So denial, trying to pass the buck, trying to say things like everybody does it and all that to overcome guilt is not the right thing to do. This is what leads to that syndrome which I always keep pointing out, that the greatest sin is the one which I don't commit. When I'm very confident that I don't do this sin, I keep pointing out to that. I don't drink alcohol ever. Any discussion, anything going on which could lead to some thing which I am doing wrong. See, all these people drink alcohol. I don't drink alcohol. So I pass the buck very easily. But as I told you, these are only ways and means of just, you know, trying to brush it off. In the long run, it neither convinces other people nor it helps you to build a better relationship. And more than that, it doesn't, help you yourself also, because 100% you cannot convince yourself. Somewhere deep down in your subconscious or unconscious mind, you know that what you are doing is wrong. Now, what are the areas in which people feel guilty? See, everybody doesn't feel guilty on every aspect. For example, I may cheat on income tax, but then I don't feel guilty about it at all. Everybody does it. Government's policies are bad. You see, if they had reduced the income tax, I would have very honestly paid it. But why do they charge so much? That's why I don't pay it. So I put in my justification. So even if I am doing something very obviously wrong in terms of, you know, cheating on tax or something of that sort, I'm okay with it. But if I do something else, which has got something, for example, one of the greatest areas of guilt, very often, is something to do with religion or faith or spirituality. The moment you have infringed on something, and there are enough and more, you know, middlemen, agents of God, commission agents as they are called, who will make sure that you feel guilty. So even if I am doing a ritual in which I was supposed to keep this laptop in front of me and then this light in front of me, but I put the light first and then the laptop, they'll say you're a sinner. So that is one area in which very, very difficult to overcome the guilt factor, because it is perpetually drilled into you that. And the unknown factor is so strong in this that it is not just that I'm going to suffer in this world. There is one, huge central jail waiting for me when I die and go, and I'm going to be tortured out there. They're just waiting for me. Mr. Yamraj is ready to pick you up and take you there and throw you into that jail. So you can't even live peacefully in this world thinking that that is what is going to happen to me. So many other ways in which, you know, morality with regard to man-woman relationship, fidelity, this, that. There are some people who just don't feel guilty about it, and there are some people who say that that is the worst sin that you can ever commit in your life. Why the difference? Why is it that one person feels this way and another person feels that way? Starting from your upbringing and indoctrination, going right up to the fact that I told you, greater sin is the one which I don't commit. So if I do something, I want to pass the buck, and those type of things. Okay. One thing that happens with guilt is, when I start feeling guilty, I start getting choked in, right? I start feeling miserable with myself. As I told you, I am my worst enemy. I start thinking that I have done this wrong thing, I should not have done this, all that goes on in my mind. When that is going on, human tendency is to get it off your chest by sharing it with somebody. Now there comes a very tricky thing. If I choose the wrong person to share with, I am expecting some sympathy, some support. So I go to X and I say, I need to talk to you. I've been feeling miserable so many days. I've not been sleeping properly. I think I've done this wrong thing. I wanted to talk to you. And I pour it out. And that person turns around and says, never thought you were such a horrible guy. You actually did this, is it? Oh my God. Finished. Now it has got reinforced back to me. Including, I have got some friends working in the police department who tell me that in our country we don't have those very high-tech investigative tools to find out who did the crime. He says most of the criminals are caught because they want to share with somebody. I go and commit a dacoity, I go and commit a murder, I do something, I get away with it. Nobody has caught me. Investigation by the authorities and this and that, they don't manage to catch me, the case is closed. Now I am safe. But that inner desire, what have I done? How have I done? Nobody knows about it. So finally, one day I go to that liquor shop, get drunk over there and start telling this fellow, you know what I did? I killed that fellow and I'm feeling miserable about it. That fellow goes and tells somebody, that fellow has some contact in the police, and before you know it, I'm caught. Now, why does that happen? When a person knows that he has got away, the investigation has been closed and he is 100% safe. But it is the guilt factor inside him which is eating him up. And that's why I said that just suppression of the guilt doesn't help. And definitely, as I said, talking to the wrong person doesn't help. The same thing applies to sharing with your own family members. Many a time our family members are the most judgmental. They don't tolerate something which other people can tolerate. So when I go and tell something to somebody who is my near and dear, family member, whatever I want to call it, again that can have a very bad impact. And unlike the other person whom I shared with in the liquor shop, this person I'm living with probably 24/7. So every day now I have to bear this thing of, you did that, you are a horrible guy, you did this, you did that, and they keep pointing this out. In so many cases I've come across, for example, a young person gets into an affair before marriage, no commitment, no nothing. Some sort of fling, affair, whatever you want to call it, it doesn't work out, it fizzles off. And then this person gets married. And this person is feeling guilty that I must share with my life partner that I did this before marriage. And this person goes ahead and shares. And lifelong he or she has to listen. You did this. You are a horrible person. When you did it at that time, how do I know that you are not doing it now also? So these are some of the factors that we really have to be careful about. On the one side, as I told you, you can choke inside and you can feel very miserable if you don't share. And if you share with the wrong person, you can be in deeper trouble. There is, one very strong element which I want you to keep in mind. One is, as I told you, the indoctrination, where people it's your upbringing that you were told that these are values, these are morals, this is to be done, this is not to be done, and all that. And the moment you transgress anything of that sort, you are made to feel miserable. Very often, it is nothing to do with morals. And yet, it is converted into morals. Let's say a very conservative family. A growing girl is told that you should wear only this type of dress and you should not wear that type of dress. See, from the point of view of decency or, you know, being more acceptable in society or being a little more protected, it's all right. But when it comes to, let's say, something like morals, if you wear this type of dress, you are an immoral girl. Good girls, girls who maintain their values and morals, they wear only this type of dress. Now you visualize what sort of havoc this plays in the mind. And somebody, but the moment, this is a very interesting thing. If you tend to be the type of person who feels guilty, who gets, you know, inwardly upset and starts blaming yourself and things of that sort, there's always somebody around to take advantage of that. So the moment I say that I'm feeling guilty because I did this, there will always be somebody to take advantage of that. And who takes advantage and how they do that, I will tell you, as they say in the TV series, after the break. So there are nice people in there?
Yes, yes,
I like. I like people. I've got a lot of dead people also sitting over there. Here.
I'll just turn the camera a little bit.
Something to say.
Hi, so every third Thursday we go, we have a classroom session, a helping hand talk on various topics. So you're most welcome. You can get in your friends, you can get your family, and come and attend the talk. So most welcome. And anyway, you're welcome to Banjara anytime. We are all here. Right?
Say my big enough visible enough.
Yes, I think this is what we are doing.
Please be aware and careful about, you know, these predators who are looking around to find somebody who is vulnerable. It's like if you have a tendency to keep your house unlocked, there will always be some people lurking around who will find out after some time that there is a pattern. Your house is very often unlocked and people go out and there's nobody there, you will take advantage. So if you keep your mind, you know, unlocked to receive inputs from others, there are always people who are willing to take advantage. Let's say somebody tells me that, hey, what you did is wrong, yeah. And I turn around and say, what's your problem? I know what I'm doing is right or wrong. You don't have to lecture to me. That person was so upset and that person was saying that Ali has upset me and all that. Hey, listen, my intentions are good. I don't go about hurting. Now, if that person decides, then what happens? People back off. They say this person is not accessible or vulnerable. But if somebody comes and tells me, Ali, you should not have done that. Do you think that is the right thing to do? Don't you think that, you know, this is not a right thing? And I say, who is it? I shouldn't have done it, is it? Oh, I didn't realize. Ah, I think that was the wrong thing to do. Now they know that they can catch hold of me. So therefore, people who accept guilt easily, they are made to feel more and more guilty by people who have their own vested interests. I can control this person by making him or her feel guilty. Now that person will oblige me because I have drilled it into this person that you are guilty. Anything that you do, you are responsible. This starts with the most horrendous cases like child molesters. Innumerable child molesters that I have heard of, they tell the victim that it is you who's responsible. You caused this, you were enjoying this, you were coming and asking for this and things of that sort. So the child, the victim actually grows up feeling that I am guilty, I am the person who has done the wrong thing, not that I am the victim of somebody else's wrong doing. And once that self-esteem goes down and the person starts believing that I am not a good person and that, you know, I am guilty of doing all sorts of wrong things, it is so easy for somebody else to step in and say something of that sort. It's like that joke of the person who comes and says, will you lend me 100 rupees? Okay, he's a friend, I'll lend it, you'll give it back. Well, yeah, definitely I'll give it to you. I just want a loan, please give it to me. So when I'm taking out that 100, he says, no, just give me 50 right now. Okay, you want 50, you take it. Then he says, okay, I've taken only 50 from, so I owe you 50. Yeah, you owe me 50. And the balance 50, you have not given me, no? So you owe me 50 rupees. So I owe you 50, you owe me 50. Now we are clean, right? Bye-bye. And this person is left wondering what has happened. I've lost 50 rupees and I owe him 50 and he owes me 50. I mean, this is a joke, this is an exaggeration, but it's actually how these things work. You were supposed to do this for me, you didn't do it. So if I have done some horrible things or I'm taking advantage of you, what's wrong with that? It becomes exactly like that. You know, I owe you 50 and you owe me 50, that sort of thing. Please be very careful of these type of people. And remember that these people can do a lot of emotional blackmail, take advantage of so many different ways that you can. And that is what I want, that vicious cycle should be, you know, broken somewhere. People who impose themselves by saying, if it weren't for you, you are the one who has done this. It is because of you. A person who has become a chronic alcoholic says, I am lonely, nobody loves me, therefore I am an alcoholic. You marry me, you love me, I will give up drinking, I will never drink in my whole life. 5 years later, he is drinking more than what he was drinking earlier. Now you ask him, what happened? My wife nags me, that's why I drink. And it becomes endless. I'm sad, that's why I drink. I've been scolded, that's why I drink. I'm being nagged, that's why I drink. I'm very happy, that's why I drink. I'm celebrating, that's why I drink. Now these type of people never feel guilty, but they do succeed in making the other person feel guilty. Imagine a very sensitive, caring, loving wife who is told by her husband, see, after marriage, I had given up drinking. For such a long time, I didn't drink. No? Why do you think I'm drinking now? All because of you. Now, what do you do in these sort of circumstances? But what you can do, I'll come to that in a minute, is number one, how to protect yourself, and number two, how to get out of that thing of the guilt. Before I start on that, let me also tell you a couple of factors or situations where guilt can be very strong. One is what we call as this survivor's guilt. I had a younger brother who died. He was 5 years younger than me. I don't deserve to be living. I'm 5 years older than him. Why did he have to die? And why is it that I'm still alive? I'm giving a very, you know, abstract example, but it can happen anywhere. Why did this happen to such and such person and why not to me? I am the greater sinner, I am this, I am that. And yet, see, I am happy and I am surviving and I am doing so many things, whereas so many other people are, you know, suffering. This happens even in calamities. There is some major earthquake or building collapse or tsunami or something, and so many people die. And I don't die. I come out. I should be happy. I should be celebrating. No, no. I get into what is known as survivor's guilt. So many nice people who deserved to live, they died. Small children who were in the beginning of their life, they died. Sudden such person, even though he was older than me, but he was such a nice person. He had done so much good. If he had lived, he can do so much good to society. He died. And look at me. I'm still surviving. That is something to be very careful about whenever you come across somebody who has seen somebody else suffering very badly, somebody close or something of that sort. Please check out if that person is getting survivor's guilt. The other one, which is perhaps even more common, is what we refer to as caretaker's guilt. Somebody falls sick and I tend to that person, I take care of that person, but for whatever the reason, the person passes away. Inevitably, I am left with the feeling I didn't do enough. I am guilty of neglecting this person. If I had taken this person to such and such doctor, maybe he would have been alive. If I had done this, maybe he would have been alive. So, even though here I am the caretaker, I have done so much in the last days of that person. Instead of feeling positive about myself that, see, at least I could help in whatever way in the last days when this person was so sick. I tended, I nursed him, I did this and that. I am left with what we call as the caretaker's guilt. This I have seen comes out so often. See, because that's our way of justifying this very miserable feeling that why did I lose this person. So I try to justify it by saying that could I have done something more? And that question of could I have done something more converts into I should have done something more. And that leads to I have not done sufficient. And therefore I am guilty. I have caused whatever this thing that has happened to this person. There are a lot of things which people actually start believing when they start going deeper and deeper into guilt. I just jotted them down and I'll share it with you. We develop a sort of syndrome whereby we say, no matter what I do, I am always wrong. And therefore, I don't deserve to be happy. This is a typical pattern that no matter what I do, I'm always wrong. I never do the right things and therefore, I don't deserve to be happy. I am responsible for the happiness of my loved ones, my best friends, my so and so. I am responsible for their happiness, and if they are unhappy, it is my fault. Now, they are unhappy due to 100 different reasons, but because I have taken on this responsibility that I am responsible, I should make my parents happy, I should make my spouse happy, I should make my children happy, or whatever it is. And the moment I find that they are unhappy, I start blaming myself. So this is a guilt for something which I have not even done. Similarly, people who say that there's only one right way, that's what I keep reminding you of this indoctrination. That if there are very rigid, very clear-cut norms laid down that only this is permissible, everything else is a sin or something, then the person can succumb to guilt very badly. It is bad to be concerned about myself. As it is, I'm such a horrible person. Now I'm thinking about my pain, my relief, how do I get out of it, whereas I have caused harm to others. So even those little efforts that I can make to relieve my pain and anguish because of the guilt, I stop doing that. And then, as I mentioned earlier also, everybody must be looking down at me, everybody must be judging me, people must be thinking what a horrible person I am. Don't you know that that person my neighbor, he was walking past. He didn't even look in my direction. He turned his head that way and walked off. So he must be knowing what a horrible person I am. So that's why he didn't even want to greet me. Whether that person didn't even notice that I'm walking past, or he was busy in his own thoughts or whatever it is. But everything keeps coming back to me and putting the blame on me. And since I am such a horrible person, I have to keep giving to others. I have to keep obliging others. I have to be extremely nice to others. And that, as you know, never works. The more you are nice to people, the more they take advantage of you, the more they control you, the more they make you feel guilty. So this last one is extremely important. You do not have to compensate for the so far bad thing that you have done by being consistently nice, either to this person who made me feel guilty or to other people in general. Now come to the last part. What do I do in terms of overcoming this feeling of guilt? One, of course, the simplest way is that if your guilt is primarily due to your religious or faith indoctrination, that this is a sin, that is not to be done, this is bad, that is, you know, pap and punya, these, then please go back to the same appellate authority and say, can you kindly change the rules a little bit? I've done so many nice things, I've listed them out for you. So if you could have that little dialogue and try to convince the same powers that control you, somewhere along the line you will find that, you know, there is some hope if you really have that type of belief. One of the commonest things you must be knowing, in the Catholic Church there is a concept of confession. So you go inside the church, there is a little bit of a cubicle there, you go and sit down. There is a sort of mesh, you can't see the other side, but you can just know that there is a priest sitting over there, and that priest starts talking to you and says, yes, what is it? So you start off by saying, Father, I have sinned. I have committed a sin. Okay, son, come on, tell me. Tell me in minute detail what you have done. So I pour it out. And in the end, you know, the priest tells me, okay, don't do it again. Pray to God, read the scripture, do whatever it is, do good to others and this and that, and God will forgive you. So he has got, you know, that, what do you say, delegated authority that he can put his rubber stamp and say, on behalf of God, here I hereby declare that you are forgiven, so I need not feel guilty, but it works. I'm just giving that as an example. It could be any religion, any faith, any community, anything. But if you have that, it is fine. If you don't have that, now we'll run through the human angles of what you can do in terms of, you know, either avoiding or reducing the guilt. Firstly, ask yourself how vulnerable you were when you did something. So I'm supposed to have done something bad. But was it because, you know, I was being oppressed? Was it because I was pushed to a corner? Was it because I was too innocent and too young at that time to understand what is good or bad? People who do transgressions when they are teenagers very often carry it lifelong. They don't realize that I was all of 13 years or 16 years at that time. I didn't have that type of maturity and understanding and control over my life which I have today as an adult. So I, you know, sort of put that same benchmark. And I evaluate myself the way I would be evaluating another adult who does something wrong. And that is what you need to, you know, look at. Similarly, was it entirely my fault? Was there a contribution from somebody else? Yes, I am acknowledging that I should not have done this, I have done this. But was it entirely my fault? If somebody has contributed to it, let me share that you know, with him or her also. I can't be putting the entire blame on myself. Similarly, by going on feeling guilty, is it helping me? Is it helping the other person whom I'm supposed to have hurt? Is it helping in my spiritual life that I have committed a sin, so now I'm going to go on and on and on, you know, punishing myself? So what is the benefit of this strong guilt feeling that is coming into me, which is leading to certain actions which are only making my life worse. They are not in any way improving my life. And they are not even improving the life of the person whom I am supposed to have hurt or whatever it is. Let me start becoming aware of that. Then, there is one very nice simple way of looking at things objectively. I have done something bad and I am feeling guilty about it. If for a moment I stop and think, I have a sibling, I have a close friend, I have somebody whom I love and I have good regard for. I visualize, supposing instead of me, that person had done this act, would I have condemned that person? In most cases, the answer would be no. No, that person is so nice, that person does so many good things. Okay, even if he does this one bad thing, I'm not going to condemn him, I'm not going to put him or her down, I'm going to accept it. There are always reasons. See how we try to be compassionate and positive and nice, because it is a third person. So if that exercise you can do mentally, whatever I have done for which I am blaming myself and I am saying that I am a horrible person and I feel guilty about it, just presume that it was not done by me, it was done by somebody who is a loved one. The next thing is to draw a balance sheet of your good and bad. See, every organization has to have what is known as a bottom line, right? Debit and credit. As long as the bottom line stays positive, you're okay. So there may be some expenses which should not have been there, there may have been some expenses there, you spent more than what it is. But in the end, what is the bottom line? The bottom line is showing profit. Yay! We are happy. Same type of audit you can actually do for your good and bad deeds, so-called good and bad deeds. So even if I have a list of 1, 2, 3, 4 things which I have done bad, which I feel guilty about, can I counterbalance that by listing out the good things that I have done? And then checking out on the balance, whatever happens. One more thing is to ensure that I prevent this sort of thing happening again. If it is lurking somewhere, then it doesn't help, because every time I am still anxious that I may go down to doing that. Let's say I am not getting along with somebody who is close to me, and I seem to have lost my temper, I seem to have done something which I myself am regretting. That I should not have been so harsh, I should not have reacted so badly. Instead of all the time being guilty about what happened, can I use that as a lesson, as a stepping stone to ensure that next time there is a conflict, next time there is an argument, I will not resort to the reaction which I had last time. Can I practice? Can I rehearse? Can I jot down and think of the possible reactions? If I can prepare myself in advance, I will ensure that I will not keep getting pulled down into the other things. Ask yourself whether you are setting very harsh standard, like I told you, which could be because of your upbringing and those sort of things. And then one more thing which really helps in overcoming guilt is to give positive affirmations to yourself. It really helps. But it has to be practiced on a regular basis till it becomes a habit. Just to have an example, can I have any one of you giving yourself spontaneously 1, 2, 3, 4 positive affirmations that I have done this good deed, I am nice, I am doing this. Let's see how fast you can do it. Who's going to do it? Yes, that's enough.
In the morning, I look at the mirror, hug myself and say I love you so much.
In the morning, I look at the mirror, hug myself and say I love you so much. One. Second. Good deeds, nice qualities, attributes, anything. It could be a simple thing like I've got a good smile. Whenever I see people, I always smile at them. Don't you all agree with? Done. Third one.
No, normally, whatever happens throughout the day, I do feedback about everything.
Yes.
I acknowledge I take everything as a feedback, you know.
Yes.
If anything right or wrong, but then I don't take anything wrong.
Instead of putting it as a label of good or bad, I take it as a feedback.
Yes.
So when a person writes a test, a student writes a test and gives, and the teacher gives back saying this sum was correct, this was wrong, I can look at it in two ways. I can say I got only, 12 marks out of 20 in this test, or I could say, let me see where I have done right, let me see where I made a mistake, so that next test I will ensure this. using that as a means, that sort of thing. Yep.
Before I go to sleep, I tell myself that today I did what best I can do with the knowledge that I have.
Yes, I am human. I did whatever best I could do. I am not superhuman. I can't be perfect. I can't always be doing the great and, you know, the best of things. But I've done whatever it is. The day has passed off. I have not killed somebody. I have not committed a murder. I have not done anything horrendous like that. I have done some good and bad, but I have put in my best. My intentions have been good. Always remember about intentions. Even if you have hurt somebody, but it is not with intentions. Your intention was good, but you hurt somebody. Very often it happens to us as parents. I may scold or I may say something to my child and the child may feel very hurt, very upset. That does not mean that I am wrong. That does not mean that I have done something wrong. I did it with good intention, but the child is feeling hurt. Yes, I do need to make up for that. Explain to the child or whatever it is see how I can set that right, how I can improve my relationship, Seema. So I need to look into those factors, but it does not mean that I have to feel guilty or I have to look down upon myself. And last but not least, one excellent way of overcoming anything like guilt is to do good to others, what we call as social service, volunteering, doing some good gestures. Small, small things. Every day, if I do 1, 2, 3, 4 good things, somebody smiles at me, somebody says thank you to me, somebody doesn't even respond, but in my heart of hearts, I know that I have done this little gesture to this person. That goes a long way in compensating and, you know, over a period of time, reducing my guilt. So, it is possible. Can be done, but as in every other thing that I keep telling, you have to have consistency. Firstly, you have to believe that yes, there are ways and means of doing it. If I start believing that I'm a horrible person, I don't deserve to be happy, I've always been doing wrong things, then nothing can be done. So I have to break that and say, yes, I have done good things, I have done bad things, but overall my intentions are good, I'm an acceptable and good human being. I would like to improve on that. Based on that, how do I move forward? The best way, as I said, is I can do a small gesture to this son. I can smile at this friend. I can offer a glass of water to somebody. I can even do it to a stranger. If somebody is going past, I can just do a gesture or say a kind word. Or if it's a hungry person, give him something to eat or anything of that sort. If I can do that on a continuous basis, there is a very good chance that I can start bringing out this guilt and things can improve.
Your questions and comments.
So basically, you have to remove guilt from your personality.
Yes, it's a very debilitating emotion. It can hurt, it can destroy your entire life. And as I told you, it can even lead to that phenomenon of developing a guilt complex, where eventually you start believing that I am no good, I always do bad things, I always hurt people, I know some of people. Before that happens, we have to cut it down. Like, yes, sir.
The spiritual belief system, what we
develop
in to our life.
Yeah. Differentiate between what is advisable and what is the real path. I gave you the example of dressing of a girl. There are conservative families who will say, good girls don't dress like this. And any girl who dresses like that is an immoral person, loose character, that is the type of words that they use. Only because she wants to be a little fashionable, she wants to be up to date or whatever it is.
Her moral values are as high as any other person around the. So you have to differentiate. Whatever may have been the intentions of my elders when they told me this was not a power and punya. It is just that they felt as a conservative society or this or that this is what it should be done. Now I know that it is very clear. The second thing is, even when it comes to this papa and punya, is it a sin to kill somebody? Yes or no? From your upbringing, it is, right? Okay. Is it a sin to kill somebody who is coming to kill you? Is it a sin to kill somebody who is going to go and kill somebody else? And taking a gun and going and shooting him, you come and kill. Grab and in that you tell the gun and I get killed. I was not killing you. I was trying to kill somebody else, or you killed me. Is it a sin? Okay. What about a police officer who sees a criminal running away, you know, after killing somebody and he shoots him dead? Is it a sin? Okay, police officer at least knows that this fellow is a murderer, so he shot him. An army person sitting on the front sees the enemy and he shoots him. That poor fellow, he has joined his country's army because he was starving, he needed a job, so he went and joined and they pushed him to the front and he is sitting there and this soldier is killed. You give him a medal for it. You don't call it a sin. I am telling you all this is just to emphasize on the fact that this papa and punya is not a clearly divided line. I gave you two examples of that. Start using your logic and do it. If you can convince a concerned person, people slowly, gently, over a period of time, excellent. But even if they are so rigid in their thinking, you withdraw. Do not get into arguments and all that with them. But in your own life, you start practicing what you think is. You have to keep working on it. It's a long-term type of thing. It is not something that happens overnight. But once you believe in it, you have to be able to persist.
In a relationship with one of the person is actually manipulating or making the other person feel very guilty.
Exactly.
And the other person doesn't even know. The person gets manipulated and over the long run, like slowly it dawns upon the person that okay, I have not actually done anything wrong, but I have been made guilty, feel guilty throughout my life for things which I shouldn't be like feeling guilty.
Right.
How to confront that person, because the person is not ready to accept that, because for like at that point of time, the picture that is given is that I'm your savior, I'm trying to help you, I'm there to help you, it's only because of me you are.
That's right, that's right.
How do you confront them?
There are two aspects to it. One is confrontation. One is to improve your own quality of life in your beliefs. The second one is first. First, I have to be absolutely convinced that I was under an illusion all these days because this person was manipulating me. Now I have developed the rationality, the maturity, the intellect to understand that this is not right. First, convince yourself that I am right. Let there be no guilt. Once you overcome the guilt, then take a choice. Do I need to confront him, which can make matters worse and he's the type of person who will never listen to me? In which case, I go ahead and start bringing changes in my own life and minimize the impact of what this person is doing. On the other hand, if you think that it can work, there's no harm in putting in that effort. But as I was saying, it can take a very long time. It requires a lot of consistency, persistence, whatever it is. If that relationship is important enough for you, and somewhere there is that hope that this person is not an evil person, not a bad person, there is a chance that I will make this person introspect. Do put in that effort. Go back and try it out. Have a lovely day.
Thank you for joining us. See you third Thursday again. Right? Just to tell you quickly, the classroom session of diploma or diploma DCS and counseling skills, the admissions are open. And I would just want DCS 22 students to stay back. Okay, we'll do a little 15 minute of discussion on today's topic, right? And anybody else also who wants to join. So let's sit and introspect on, you know, 15 minutes. Let's introspect on what we discussed just now. All right. Coming back to you. So online program of CCAD also is coming up on 15th of May. That is Child and Adolescent Development. So if you want to understand as a significant adult, children, and you know, as a teacher or as a mother, you want to understand about children or adolescents from 0 to 18 years, you can enroll. It's a completely online program. So there'll be one classroom and one mentoring session. Everything online. Mentoring, you can come and do it in Banjara also. So if you want more information on the CCAD program, let us know. And going back to DCS, it's starting in the month of June. It's an exclusive classroom program. So that's the only way you can learn counseling, right? So please, anybody who's interested, let us know. All right, on that note, see you again. FB Live Saturday, once again, and every third Thursday for some time, at least till this situation is like that. We'll try and see if we can go live. Otherwise, we would love to have you in the classroom. Okay, take care. Bye-bye.